We're here to kickstart a project to reverse this watershed death spiral, to help our clients maximize the health and productivity of their land. To do this, we start with water, land, and vegetation, observing this landscape and how it receives or rejects the rain. Listening to the land to learn the ways to enhance its hydration and resulting life capacity. Greece is a landscape of incredible beauty, but also real tragedy. There, you can experience the bones of a landscape with the potential to be endlessly productive. Thousand-year-old chestnuts and olives, fruit trees raining figs from the sky. But increasingly, the story of this landscape is a tragedy. While there, nearby burned one of the biggest fires in Europe, followed by flood with immense destruction. The land is sick and suffering, the waterways drying up. 40 years ago, EU subsidies were introduced that gave farmers money for each goat that they had on the landscape. What this has resulted in is maximum number of goats. They don't really milk or harvest or use the goats for anything like was intended by the subsidy. Rather, they're just farming the government for those subsidies. So here you can see an area where the animals are actually fenced out of the landscape. You see all of this green growth, really lovely and beautiful. And at the same time, you see across the landscape, just totally desolate, barely anything for the animals to eat. And this mountain that used to be green and lush is now brown and barren and nothing but stones and goat poop. And so it's really important that we recognize that it takes a tremendous amount of labor and effort and careful management for animals to have a beneficial impact. And when animals are merely just put on the landscape, they can have this really destructive impact. In this case, you see no young trees. The climate of the island is changing where it's raining less and less. Water sources are drying up. And this is all because of overgrazing and the vast number of goats that have been put on this island. As you develop your skills reading the landscape, you'll find that things really start speaking to you. The trees start speaking to you, the plants, and even the rocks and the soil. And so here, this feature is quite interesting, but it actually tells a really sad, disturbing, and concerning story. So you might be thinking, how on earth did this rock get on top of this column of soil? But actually, the rock has been here the whole time, and the soil around this has all washed away. The goats have just been destroying and denuding this landscape. And what has happened is as they clear the vegetation, when the rain comes, it washes away the soil. And you see, this is almost 20 centimeters, nearly a foot of erosion. So it's a huge amount of loss of topsoil, fertility, growing capacity of this landscape. But not just that, all of this rich and fine sediment washes out into the ocean, where it causes eutrophication, algal blooms, dead zones, and impairs and injures the fisheries even in the ocean. So this is a huge sickness to the landscape. These goats have really caused immense disturbance on this island, and you can see it in the ways that the stones and the soil show you that. Here in Greece, we've been working for the last month to help implement a concept plan that we helped develop 2 years ago. And so in this case, in this area where I'm standing, there's actually springs and seeps that come out of the ground here all winter long in the rainy season. as it was previously, they were just quickly washing into the draw and right down into the ocean. So this very dry, desiccated landscape that struggles with water through the long, hot, dry summers, all of the water was leaving all winter long. And so a big part of this concept plan is a network of terraces that help weave that water back and forth across the landscape. So in the winter, when this spring water is coming out of the hillside here, instead of moving right to the wash and right to the ocean, this network of terraces is going to gently and slowly weave that water back and forth across the landscape. So that instead of just a couple meters down to the wash and down to the ocean, it's got to travel more than a kilometer back and forth across this landscape to help hydrate it and help build up a lot of water and fertility for the summers. Here, this terrace is a really simple feature that's absolutely critical for how this land receives water. So previously, all of the water coming out of the land here was just flowing into this wash and quickly down into the ocean. Now this terrace is going to gently carry it across the landscape, helping to hydrate all of the areas that are higher and drier. So this terrace is really gently inward-leaning. And whereas we usually like to have a nice gentle pitch along the length, here, because of constrictions of property boundaries, where the spring water is coming out in the winter, and other infrastructure on the site, we had to have a steeper grade. And so this water would erode this terrace over time, and you can see we've armored a little rock spillway in the heel of the terrace so that all of that water flow can safely dissipate its force along those rocks as it weaves between them, and we can softly and safely carry that water across to help hydrate the drier parts of the landscape. This is the top terrace in our system, and so this terrace is gently inward leaning, so it's sloped into the hill, and then it's got a very gentle pitch, 1 in 100 along the length of it towards me. And so as water comes, as rain comes, the first bit of water infiltrates into the terrace. Then as the soil hits holding capacity, it gently moves to the back of the terrace, along the length of the landscape, and to this stone spillway, where it starts to get a little bit steeper. So this stone spillway prevents any erosion and moves it downhill into the next terrace that helps distribute this across the landscape. Here again, we've got an area where this terrace empties out onto a steeper area. So we've got this transition from soft to steep. As soon as it becomes steep, we've begun rock armoring it and carrying it down this spillway to a small sediment trap uphill of the water body, again to catch any sediment before it enters and continues down into the nice natural swimming pond we've created. Here, this natural swimming pond is the main project we've been working on over the past couple of weeks. It's taken the most time, the most energy, and I'm really happy with what we've achieved here. We've created, just with the very limited amount of clay that was available in this site, we've created a keyway dam across here, and we've used the clay to line the basin as well in this case, because it was really rocky, permeable material that was a little bit concerning for a water body. And you can see here we've created a deep zone, we've created a shallow zone where plants can establish. Our next steps are to plant aquatic plants all around the edge of this to help filter and comb the nitrates and phosphates out of the water, keep the water quality really high. You can see we've created a lot of stones that are partway in the water, partway out of the water, to act as thermal conductors to bring that solar energy into the water, creating a nice microclimate in the water for insects And it's amazing just how quickly life happens. We already have oarsmen, we have dragonflies and damselflies laying eggs in the water already. And you can see we've created a lot of nice features for some good human interaction points. Boulders to sit on in the sun to dry off and warm up after swimming. Stairs to get in and out of the water. We've got this nice rock to jump into the water. We've actually got a stone wall below it so you can dive off of this rock. You can sit on the rock with your legs in the water. You've got this nice backrest here. We've also got a submerged pile of rocks in the water to create more habitat for aquatic species. And so this water body is really going to provide a lot for this property. It's going to provide beautiful fresh water to swim in and cool off in the long hot summers. It's going to provide water for irrigation in emergency situations if water runs out or is limited. It's going to provide water for fire and other emergency situations like that where you need a big volume of water all at once. And it's really going to help create this lush, nice microbiome within this little place where it's going to be more humid. The water is going to seep into the landscape and provide abundant water for trees and plants around the uphill edges here. And it's really going to provide a lot of life and habitat for a lot of the predatory insects to help control pests in the garden. And so I really like to make water bodies like this really inviting to human interaction so that you want to come and sit at the rocks at the edge and watch the insects. You want to come swim in the water. You have easy ways to get in and out. We also, in this case, have a pebble beach here behind me, providing a nice, low, shallow ramp so that people who are less physically able can easily get in and out of the water. We have our spillway coming in here, sediment trap up above, and our spillway coming out and wrapping around to the rest of the landscape. Usually we can't fill up a water body right away. In this case, they have an abundance of water from a creek uphill that's quickly going into the ocean. And so we're able to fill this water body basically right away. And so it looks so inviting here, I think I'm gonna take a swim. Here, this is a new kind of feature for us, something I've never built before, a couple of rice paddies. So they're very experienced and into Masanobu Fukuoka's methods. They're in a great climate for growing rice in the summer and then another grain in these paddies over the winter. And so here we created two stepped paddies and you'll see that there's a pipe in it. We haven't yet gotten the 90 degree part, but that will be like a Holzer Monk, where we'll have the horizontal pipe going through the berm of the paddy and then a vertical pipe with a 90 degree so that they can rotate that to set exactly the level of the paddy that they like. So we've made an overland spillway so that even if the pipe's overwhelmed or clogged, there's a safe way for the water to exit that holds about 30 centimeters, a little bit more than a foot of water. But then with that monk pipe, that 90 degree swing elbow, they'll be able to set the water level to whatever height they want, whether they want to drain it, have the full 30 centimeters or anything in between, they can adjust the pitch of that elbow in order to accomplish that. So here we've left the soil in the paddies quite loose. We haven't compacted it a lot, so it infiltrates quite quickly. But the time that they'll be flooding these paddies, they have a surplus of water from the mountain above. And so they can leave the water slowly and constantly trickling into these paddies to fill them up, to flood out all of the competition, to facilitate the growth of rice in these paddies, which will then be followed by another grain in the winter. So I'm really excited to see how these fare and how they work with them.
Are you ready to rejuvenate landscapes, restore ecosystems, and even revive rivers? To move beyond the theory and start practicing ecosystem regeneration? To succeed, you'll need skills, support, and confidence. It's why I created the Water Stories Core Course, to empower you to heal landscapes and revive waterways with your own hands and heart. I've spent the past decade implementing projects all around the world. Not theoretical designs, but real results on land. I put all of the lessons I've learned from working with legends like Sepp Holzer and Rajendra Singh into this course. The Water Stories Core course gives you everything you need to actualize projects on the ground and in your community. For each module, actions guide you through the experiences you'll need to become competent and then confident reading and regenerating land. From the technical aspects of earthworks and ecosystem establishment to the personal development you'll need to be effective, to providing a business roadmap for success, this course offers a transformational experience that reshapes your relationship with water, land, and life. As hopeful as I was when we began, even I've been surprised how quickly it's delivered results for our students. No matter where you live and no matter your background, you can help heal the earth with water cycle restoration. Check the link below for upcoming courses, and I'll see you in class.